Welcome everybody here to the HyperX Trilogy Tour. For the first time in a very long time, Cap, we get to stream out of our studio together. I don't think we've actually done it together yet.
No, we haven't.
No, it's been a while.
Like every single time it's been separate.
Yeah. I've been working or he's been working or I've been traveling or he's been traveling or we've both been traveling or...
Yeah.
We've never been together in the same place twice because we've just been so busy even though we're not casting anything.
That's right. Join Dota isn't dead.
Yeah, well...
You should see. You should see like if I were to like go and do a little bit of streaming or something like that or I'm playing with somebody else who's streaming.
Yeah.
It's like, so what's happened to Join Dota? And I'm just like, it's dead.
Yeah,
we killed it. It's done.
You know,
I told everybody I'm going back to America. You're going back to Australia. Join Dota's over. Dream is dead.
It's a lot of easier.
We've been like gone like a month. Well, with small streams in between.
Yeah, yeah, and like we're down in Baku. We're down in like I was over in Bucharest. You're over in Taiwan. I was like, Join Dota's doing nothing. I was like, actually, we've been doing a hell of a lot of late. But don't
worry.
Just
because you don't see it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. If a tree falls in the middle of the wood, doesn't make a sound. Yes, it does. If a caster streams and nobody watches,
if you pull out a box with a cat
casting?
Dead inside,
yes,
I'm gonna get really annoyed with you. You can't kill cats. Let's get to the game, man. Let's get to the game. Okay. So what we're doing tonight, if you guys don't know about it, you can head yourself over to the wonderful website of joindota.com, where you can check out the coverage page for it all. It is the Trilogy Tour. We are into the quarterfinals right now. It's actually the second last quarterfinal game to be played. Mm-hmm. It's a double elimination bracket. We're sticking with the winners bracket all the way through. It's just a fun, small tournament. It's mainly done to try and spice up the Turkish scene. It's actually done by a whole bunch of Turkish organizers, but they invited the Russians and of course their brothers the Ukrainians into the tournament, so they're able to battle it out. So as far as our teams, which are getting their way through, X Game, which I know everyone kind of knows from the old days, used to be known as XKZ, used to be known as every other name under the sun, they were actually knocked out recently by ArtStyle's team. ArtStyle's team has managed to get their way through the lower part of the bracket of the winners bracket, so they're known as NIP, which is obviously very confusing for Counter-Strike GO fans, but they are NIP. And they're waiting to see who they're going to go up against, either SS or Aspiro, whose game is still to be confirmed. The winner of this game will face up against Hellraisers in the winner's bracket semi-final. Hellraisers got a 2-1 victory over Power Rangers. I know you got to cast that game, Cap. You were doing that one last night, I think it was?
Yeah, it was. I called it that it was going to be a three-game, a full best of three, and sure enough it was. It was pretty back and forth, but... I have to say, like, I actually think it's kind of fun casting these kind of games because you know that these teams have skill.
Reserve time.
Like, Power Rangers versus Hellraisers, like, both of those teams have skill. They're two of the best tier 2 teams, I would say. Like, both of them have provided a lot of upsets. Power Rangers, of course, have been around for a while and have done that constantly. But Hellraisers kind of, like, up and coming in the last, like, 3 or 4 months. People have sort of started paying attention to them and going, oh, holy crap, look at that. They, you know, upset a tier 1 team or something like that. So it's kind of fun to watch these teams battle up against each other because you know they have a lot of skill. It's just they need more time to flesh out what they already have and just get better teamwork, better synergy. And it's beginning to show. Like, Hellraisers, I would say... that the only reason they lost their match up against Power Rangers was because game number one was a Terrorblade pick that they didn't expect. So it was actually a 5th pick Terrorblade.
Radiant
like team. Very, very last pick Terrorblade. It was kind of weird to see that happen. But, you know, every scene has its own meta.
That it does. Well, let's look at the current one, which is up. So we're going with... what feels like old standard. Obviously, we weren't really seeing this hero at all. I know for everyone who's watching the summit over the weekend, I actually don't even remember Centaur being flagged by any team
not really.
Through the matches. So, well, Moscow 5 are gonna go with it. It kind of works for their style as well. Moscow 5, like, it's PGG. They either run in or they run away. Like, that's... and normally it's the first. So, the Centaur kind of works perfectly for that one. It's some good stun combinations coming out. Good engage, disengage. Everything kind of look for. A bit of an aura. Everything's nice. Wave of Terror also nice up against the Doombringers. They've never got any armor anyway. Producer Gaming, it feels a lot... very secure. Like, Doombringer, it's hard to go wrong with him financially. Even harder to go wrong with him when you've got a Dazzle babysitting the back of him. And Ogre Mashai is good at any point of the game.
Mm-hmm.
I was actually watching... it was a combination that NIP was running the other day. And they ran Wisp and Ogre Mashai dual offlane. Now, normally that would sound like complete stupidity. But they put an Orb of Venom on the Ogre Mashai. And they went up against a defensive tri lane and they were actually trading kills left, right, and center.
Yeah.
and getting on top of it, because they just had no one could run away from it. Was just nothing but slows, and they had no leap or blink escape heroes. So it was actually really, really effective. So Ogumagai, I never underestimate this guy, especially into the later portion of the game too. If you get a long duration multicast, that hold duration is just ridiculous.
For sure. I actually, there are two different things I want to point about this draft and the meta in general. I think that the Summit has really shown that a lot of teams have picked up. You saw it a little bit in DreamHack, but the Summit especially, that a lot of teams are really picking up on exactly how strong Ventral Spirit is in the current patch. In my interview with PPD at DreamHack, that was one of the things that really stood out to me. Was I asked him about underlight utilized heroes, and we were obviously talking before the interview, and I was trying to get that answer out of him, that Ventral Spirit is their favorite pickup right now, and for good reason. And a lot of it actually comes down to a small mechanic change, which is that that Wave of Terror that is able to pull creeps off of towers. So again, like, this whole entire meta has changed the fact where we're no longer able to push down towers as easily, so we can't run those, like, really aggressive five-man push lineups that we saw at TI4 that just, you know, generally snowballed everything. We no longer can see that for several reasons, one of which being some small mechanics changes, obviously the tower changes as well. These small things actually build up to completely change the meta. And even though we are still seeing a lot of five-man lineups, they're not necessarily all in like they used to be. They're not as heavily focused on pushing.
Yeah, the closest I kind of feel we ever get to five-man lineups is 4 Protect 1 still.
Remaining. Yeah.
And that still happens with groups like VG Gaming, for example, which is displaying that with their anti-mage kind of style picks. Where it's just, you get 4 heroes who are really good at just roaming and killing. And like, you get that from Deuce's first three heroes as well, like Slark, Dazzle, and Ogre. That's great killing potential when they're ready to finally inflict the damage. I'm interested to see how they're going to do it with their lanes, of course, because you've got to fit the Doombringer into it all as well. And he doesn't have to be part of the ganking group. He can just sit back, farm, and then be completely unstoppable. But then again, we're getting a Tuskar, a Troll Warlord, together from Moscow 5 here in the second phase.
This is pretty interesting from Moscow 5. I love what they're doing right now. So the Tuskar, I think, is a heavily underutilized support right now. He is absolutely a beast if you know how to play him well. That snowball has abilities like, there are certain supports that have the potential to be incredibly high impact, but most of them, you think about, it's because of their ultimates, right? The Enigma, a great example of a big game changer when he's able to throw down a big black hole. But Tuskar is one of those heroes who can consistently make big plays with that snowball, because it's so good at being able to, both as an offensive ganking pickup, but also defensive saving mechanism. It is an incredible ability that can do so much. It's just a very high skill ceiling. You have to not only be able to judge snowball itself and judge the distance and how close you need to be to your allies or etc., but also just reading situations. It's all about reading situations with snowball. But the Troll Warlord, you know, this is going to be a combination with something. They can't just, with their current lineup, they have a lot of minus armor, they have a lot of physical damage actually, but you know there's got to be some sort of cheesy combination here that's going to be coming up for this fifth pick. Troll and something.
Yeah, the only other thing which it could be is something which I know... I don't know if you really want to run Void with this Moscow 5 line, because the second you do that, like, I know Troll can switch himself to being a ranged hero, but it's not the combination I'm searching for. I'm thinking it's a Tuskar roll in to get early first blood, then they just keep the momentum. So it's got to be some level of momentum-based hero coming in for Moscow 5's last one, and they will move aggressively into Deuce's jungle and try and kill them.
I would agree that the synergy between Void and Centaur is very lacking. So that's just sort of the first hero that showed up to me that was, what's a hero that really it gets a big advantage out of that gigantic attack speed boost when you're running a Troll Warlord mid, and the first one that came to mind was Void, that hasn't been banned away.
See, I would look for the other hero, which is really favorite, which is Phantom Assassin. Easily able to move, easily able to follow, and with high attack speed. You obviously don't need the Tuskar Snowball to get you in, but you got such great chase ability with Centaur ulti as well. I would kind of go down that line. The only issue I'm then having is, will PABR do anything when doomed? Like, that's kind of like the only other thing which is like a question mark, because you rely on your Phantom Strike to move around. They're gonna try it anyway.
You know what's another really interesting one, Toby, that I've yet to see in competitive play, and I think part of it is because many teams don't like this hero, but the Spectre Troll Warlord. Think about
really?
That. When you pop your ultimate, you pop your ultimate.
Do all your illusions actually get the attack speed?
I believe so. I could be wrong on that. Somebody in chat can let us know, I'm sure. But
yeah, I'll definitely, like, if that's actually, that would be a legit combo. The only downside then is you're still running two cores without any real control. Like, yeah. Troll Warlord, sure, he's got a bash percentage chance, but you, like, everything comes out of pure intimidation. So if you don't get a good start, you're kind of screwed.
And also, to quote Eternal Envy, Spectre is shit. he thinks that's, like, the worst carry in the game. So, you know, it's a hero that can be lacking for a lot of people right now. Despite the fact when 6.82 first came out, Spectre was all the rage, mainly because of the big slingshot effect of where you were able to... where you are able to be very, very far behind, but just pick up one or two prepare kills and all of a sudden skyrocket ahead in net worth and actually be a very, very big impact. So this last pick, Phantom Assassin, is definitely interesting because it seems like they're going to be running an aggro try with it. I would assume that this is going to be Troll in the aggro try and Phantom Assassin as the mid. And the reason I say that is because I believe that Troll Warlord is a better aggro trine laner than Phantom Assassin, and Phantom Assassin as a mid, we've seen that plenty of times before.
Yeah.
So I don't think.
And Pia's gonna have no trouble. Like, she bought a poor man shield as a first item up against a Puck damage. Like, you're not gonna give a crap about that.
Yeah.
If anything, it might actually be a better idea to throw the Doombringer in towards the mid, because this top lane is gonna be so aggressive that maybe even having the Puck up here is a better option for them. Now the smoke's gonna break. It's like, it's the Dazzle walk through the tree line. Snowball grabs three, goes up, and Smiley, well, he'll put a frown on his spot on his dial. That's just too easy. This is what it's all like for Snowball early kills. Most of the time it's actually done from this region of the map, just below where Captain Love is right now. And then he's trying to gank there, which I think is the reason why he's actually there. But Dazzle had no idea who was coming from where.
Yeah, you know, I'm waiting for... whenever a team gets Tuskar, expect first blood attempts. Like, you should just naturally expect, okay, they're gonna go 4 or 5 man into our jungle or something like that, because it's so easy to get that first blood. All you have to do is get in within snowball range, and then the rest is easy. I'm expecting teams to start countering that. I mean, it's such an obvious thing to do. You could just bait out one hero, throw him out where you expect the 5 man to be coming, and then just wait around, like, say, a corner. You have any sort of AoE stun, and you can very easily punish that kind of aggressive snowballing, and perhaps even get 1 or 2 kills in the beginning of the game to your favor, rather than the other way around.
So let's just cap up our lanes right now. So we've got Iceberg here in the mid lane. Now, he just used his phase shift already, which just allowed, like, PGG baited it perfectly. He started the attack animation of the magic missile. Iceberg thought it was going to fly. In that kind of situation, he kind of has to wait for the projectile to be in the air before it can use his face shift, or else he's just going to get stunned up. But yeah, you're running just a harassing PGG, but it is a PA versus a Puck in the mid. Up on the top lane, it's Screen who's taking the Tuskar, who looks like he is still just playing the support role here. They're trying to give the farm over to ZXC instead. They're going up against what is a defensive tri lane with the Slark as the core. But now they're running two melees and a Dazzle up against potentially, like, okay, Snowball Initiation, all three of them in. They go on the Captain Love. The Magic Missile Stun will be there, and the Ice Shard is actually going to lock him in. The Shallow Grave will keep Captain Love alive, but then with the extra range slow from the Whirling Axe, then into the melee as well, they're all missing on their attacks. So these melee heroes do jack all, and they get controlled so heavily by these Ice Shards.
Yeah, I mean, look at this Moscow 5 lineup. Look at how healthy they are. They still have plenty of mana. They actually have plenty of health. None of them drop below half health. And they went on the Ogre. Like, the worst possible hero you could go on.
The guy with 6 armor.
Try. Yeah, that guy is like a tanky beast. And yet they still tore him up, because this combination is, again, it's all about the Tuskar and him being able to initiate like that, hold heroes in very well with the Ice Shards as a follow-up. But also the minus armor mixed in with all the physical damage that they're outputting. That once that Vengeful Spirit, like, the moment she hits level 2 and has that Wave of Terror, like, the just level 1 of Wave of Terror, it does minus 3 armor in the beginning of the game. Most heroes will drop down to 0 armor at that point. Obviously, Ogre Magi, not nearly as effective due to
the snowballing in, man. They're going right after the Slark, and then they're going to change the targets right now. Dazzle does have Shallow Grave available, and you'll get it over on Limbo, but that means they can just move their damage over to Smiley. One more attack will still kill off Limbo, but PGG, he wants the extra kill, and he'll take it as well with the Magic Missile. 4-0 now on the board in this best of three. Moscow 5 off to a brilliant start.
Yeah, they really just... they're not doing well to be able to deal with the strategy that this is. It feels like they just don't know how to deal with the Tuskar. the way you should probably be running this is have both of your heroes sitting in the back and have Slark sitting in the front. Now, sure, he's going to be harassed, but that's what the Dazzle is for. He can heal you up. And if they go on the Slark, he turns around and pounces. And then you draw that snowball deeper into your territory with a better chance to be able to possibly get some sort of upset up against this constant aggro tribe. You can drag him into the tower or possibly drag him far enough for some sort of counter TP from one of your allies. You could do so much there, but I think they're just really failing to recognize the big threat that Tuskar provides in an aggro tribe.
I'm waiting for Madden on this offlane to get the kill over an Anthem. It's the outside about having a Satter inside of him and still having the extra mana. He's got the Satter Blast, so he can actually have some surprise burst damage which would catch the Centaur off guard. At the same time, this will probably do it the same work as well. Captain Slav's just rotated himself in. One little Fire Blast done, and they will have to use that Satter Nuke if they want to get the kill. Then again, when they both get Horde Stomp underneath the tower!
Beautiful.
He actually gets the kill on the Doombringer. They came way too deep there without the creep wave. And patience was not a virtue displayed by Dusa.
Yeah, that was actually pretty well played by both sides. The fact that the Doom even tried to dodge the Hoof Stomp by backing out at one point, sure, he still ran in and actually got hit by it, but the initial intent was there, which is, okay, I need to dodge this Hoof Stomp if I want to be able to get this kill and not die in the process. But still well played by Zentar, holding off, stopping that Centaur Hoof and waiting for another opportunity. And look at this, the troll is just destroying this Slark. Not only
the reason why kills, is also you just got a haste rune over onto the Phantom Assassin. They're coming top lane. Screen's gonna walk himself in here. He's gonna ice shot up as well, and they just go deeper in. So Limbo, he has pounced himself very, very deep in, but it's not gonna take long for this PA to get over here. And PGG was waiting for the out, and Smiley walks straight into it. The snowball trying to get the extra stun time. Now they can go back over towards Limbo. He doesn't have pounce still on cooldown. The extra heal will do some damage. Now he goes for the pounce, but there's nothing they can do. The Phantom Assassin will pick up the double kill, locking them into the tree line. And I really don't understand where they're meant to go from here. The Doombringer doesn't really have any kind of transition in this game, and the puck is nowhere near getting blinked at, because we're 5 minutes in. Like, you're being run over 5 minutes in. The PA came straight back in again after picking up a double kill. So now the distance, like, between these two heroes is just massive.
Well, I think part of what they're doing is the right thing, which is Ogre Magi rotating to the bottom lane, but look at bottom.
Snowball just rolls in, gets the extra turn on the Doombringer, and with the double edge, he had enough. The Ignite's going to slow down Anthem, but he can just TP himself out, and, well, okay, maybe he can't, because the Fire Blast's going to cancel that one. I thought maybe he'd actually have some more time to get to the tree line, but Captain Love gets the solo kill onto the Centaur. I suppose that's nice, bringing the Ogre Magi closer to six.
But that's what they need to do. They need to draw attention away from the Slark at this point in time. If they could just get the Slark to level six, everything changes for him. But they can't actually sit there and... Because think about what they have for the offlaner, right? They have a Doom that's not really a hero that you can rely on to go, hey guys, they're diving our safe lane tower, can we get some help? Like, what is a Doom going to be able to provide at that point? He teleports in, he maybe does some Scorched Earth damage, he has no disables, no real nukes, he doesn't really do anything for you. So Moscow 5 are really playing off of that weakness from Dusa.
Well, actually, what really is even the effectiveness of Doom? Like, when you think about it, for any of the heroes, like, the only one which he could really affect would be Centaur, so he doesn't stampede the rest of the team. But, like, if he dooms up on the PA, you still can stampede. You can still protect him inside the snowball as well. Like, I'm actually thinking that this ultimate of his is actually, like, a non-factor.
No, Moscow 5 did really well to draft against the early pickup of a Doom, and... Now, well, look at top lane. You can see just the constant aggression from all sides.
Park. Moscow 5. He TP's in for the dream call. PGG's waiting for this, though, and there's already a jump. The phase shift hasn't been used yet, but screen into the corner and bottling himself up. He's got shards in 1 second, snowball in two, and now he can just protect himself and waste their time on PGG. The snowball comes up. It goes over to Captain Love, who will get the snowball on Tuskar. He's the first one to go down while Limbo dies in the tree line, ending up dying to that stifling dagger of the Phantom Assassin, who's chasing in deeper onto Captain's Love underneath the tower. Not the greatest idea in the world, especially as he's just lost the Troll Wardlord back next to his own tier 1 tower, and the Doom is on the PA, and the Centaur disengage, it's going to be cancelled off there. The perfect stun by Ogre Magi. The deny didn't come in there from PGG, as Cap was so praying for, but he gets a triple kill over towards the puck, and a fight which didn't look like it was really going to work for Deuce, it worked wonders.
Exactly, and I was just about to say, my point about the Doom is that he can't really help you out early on. The Puck can. You just have to wait until he's level 6, level 7, and make sure he has a TP and be ready to go. And look at that. He now has a Blink Dagger. Like, a 7.5-minute in Blink Dagger, this can completely change everything that Moscow 5 set up. The aggro try pretty much won them the game. They should have been able to win them the mid-game at the very least. And now, with an early Blink Dagger on the Puck, so much can happen with that. Dusa can actually start determining the tempo of this game, whereas Moscow 5 were the ones in obvious clear control. It was Dusa who were left on the back foot, constantly forced to react to whatever Moscow 5 did. But now, it's going to go the other way.
Yeah, that's that critical moment now. So Moscow 5, they've got to be more mindful about the map. That means they've got to keep vision on where this puck is moving. But it's rather difficult when he stole an invis rune from the top river on the 8-minute rune mark. So that's a little bit more problematic for him. But at the same time, I'm a little bit concerned that Iceberg still can't attack. Like, they used a lot to try and take that fight. Dream Call was one of the critical things, but it also capitalized on the fact that Moscow 5 was out of position. So Dusa need to force Moscow 5 out of position again for it to really work. Like, their over-aggression can be their downfall right now, because, like, you snowball yourself in, you go into towers, but if you read it correctly, like as you were saying before, during the drop, when the draft was on, Tuscar is all about reading the situation right. If Moscow 5 can read the situation right, they can still keep Dusa at bay.
Yeah, they need to be able to defend. They can't afford to let early towers go down. I think that's one of the most important things here, is that they needed to play a bit more passive in the laning phase. But when it comes down to defending towers, they should rotate these heroes around. They should make sure that Puck is ready to go in front of those towers, or at least ready to TP in and force some sort of fight. Because once they start losing towers, God forbid, if they start losing map control, then I think this game is over, because they actually have a really good Roshan taking team on Moscow 5. So if you start taking down all the tier 1 towers and taking map control over Dusa,
they're coming.
Gonna be instant.
Snowball, they're going for Iceberg. He's going to blink up, but actually ended up going over towards the Doom instead with the Puck. Dream Call in for the follow-up. Silent Screen's in a lot of trouble. PGG, Trump by Smash Space Slark going into that Shadow Dance. They cannot see him. The Double Edge, we're getting a bit of a split here, and then Hey, crits the Dazzle into Twine. Then they just move through the rest of the heroes. Or can they? Iceberg, Stifling Dagger will hit. No crit on him. And he's just bottling himself back up for safety. As Limbo wants to return back into this engagement. Maybe another dagger. He wants to blink up and then kill off the Puck. He did. He got the vision from the creep wave because the tree was down. And he is on the way out of here. Same with Troll Warlord at 68 life points. Another Stifling Dagger trying Bison Space Screen, giving the bottle charges up to the Troll Warlord. And they want to come back in again. Ice Shards a little bit off target. Just a little bit off target.
That was one hell of a team fight. Dusa played that really well. It's just, unfortunately, that last bit of that engagement where the Puck showed himself to the Phantom Assassin, they easily could have gotten that kill on the PA. If Iceberg had just played that more patiently and used his Blink Dagger to blink in silence, easily they would have gotten the PA and out. But instead, it was the other way around. He just played that a bit too greedy. Wasn't patient enough. And that fight ends up going the way of Moscow 5 because of it. The Phantom Assassin living is so huge.
Yeah. Captain Love. That's some aggressive nature right there. Iceberg's gonna jump. They are on a mission from God right now, but Okamajai is gonna lose a large portion of his armor, and there's your crit to kill him off. That TP was very optimistic. I also just want to flank too that entire fight that happened up on top lane, as we see just Scream playing with Madden. The Centaur was farming up bottom lane. He has his Blink Dagger now. So he wasn't involved in that engagement at all. Like, he let off his ultimate, and that was his only part of that fight. Like, what else were you really going to get? So he's back to his Blink Dagger, and he's looking for an opening target, which is probably going to just be Limbo, if he can get the right target. Hoof Stomp, he'll get the stun. Centaur ulti and Double Edge, but that's not enough damage. He dropped 58 life points, but it's not enough to get the kill.
Yeah, and it's one of those scenarios where you maybe
they're going mid. Dream Call over on two. Walrus Punch sending the Doombringer onto a flip-flip. And then Madden on the run. The Doom will be killing off the Troll Warlord right now just because of the tick-out damage. There's no attempt at denial coming out of Screen. Just tries to bail and leave his teammate behind. He'll still die, but then again, hiding inside the snowball. He wants a good target. Runs himself in. PGG. Missed out the Wave of Terror. It got the Slark, and now PA will come in. He crits over to Smiley to get the kill. Actually, then on the Iceberg. Crits galore. Double kill for him. And Captain Love forced to remain here. He wants to TP out. Where's the damage? It doesn't. Essentially, we'll have more time because the swap from the Vengeful Spirit, and in comes Centaur, and you'll just... Okay, he was looking to steal that kill with a Haste Road Invis. But it'll be a triple kill for the Phantom Assassin.
those crits, man. That poor puck. I mean, I would say 9 times out of 10 that puck should have been able to live through that scenario, or at least get up the cliff at the very least. But two big criticals out of the Phantom Assassin just crushes you. And I think people oftentimes disrespect the Phantom Assassin at this point in the game. Phantom Assassin is actually incredibly strong at this point in the game, where there's going to be a lot of aggression, and mobility is oftentimes the biggest key to success here. Mm-hmm. Like, if you look at the Phantom Assassin's stat, she's got 1,100 HP right now. She also isn't taking hardly any physical damage whatsoever, combined with like a heavy amount of armor, but the maxed out blur as well.
Well,
so you could
meant to be the physical damager anyway.
Like, exactly.
It's not there because Slark got shut down completely.
Yeah. It would normally be like the Slark would be your best amount of damage, but even just like you probably give what 200 to 300 damage, physical damage in average team fights. You would just say like on average, looking at the Phantom Assassin, she's probably going to take a 200. Right, but that's completely mitigated by the high amount of armor plus the blur. So she's actually decently tanky if she builds the right way, which I love the way this Phantom Assassin built. It's the double stats build. Sometimes you would go for treads here. She went for face boots here, which is perfectly fine. Like, it's still a very aggressive option. I like face boots quite a bit. But the important part, I think, is the double stats. The Ring of Akilla plus the drums. You would normally see most carries only go for one of these items, one or the other.
Because they want to transition into the Battle Fury or something like that.
Right. Like, if you look at anywhere from Spectres to Phantom Assassins, like, both of those items are an option. They go for one or the other, right? Ring of Akilla, cheaper. Also gives you mana regen, so it's a better farming item typically. The drums, though, much better stats when it comes to like bulking yourself up a bit more. Mm-hmm. Is a bit more expensive, but the movement speed is also really good for getting in and out of engagements as well. So all around, it's a better survivability item.
Considering the way they've been playing as well, like it's a team fight winner as well.
Oh yeah,
like because it's only for it's the entire team. You got troll attack speed, you got Centaur giving attack speed, you got the Tusker to move around. So with this entire combination put together, you've actually got Moscow 5 able to continue a fight for 20 seconds with very, very high movement speed, if not a little bit greater than that. And then you're going up against a team which, like, you got that first jump from Puck, and then it's over. You got stun control from Ogre and Ignite, but it kind of gets taken off, the slow part of that, by the abilities of Moscow 5. And Doombringer's not going to be outrunning you anytime soon. This guy's not building in for, like, you can see him right there with phase boots and Scorched Earth. Sure, he's going to run, but you run a crap ton faster, and you got control abilities like Ice Shard Swap, Magic Missile, and even, like, range Whirling Axes, which also add another slow on top. So you got all of these different things which just work for Moscow 5, and they know they want to fight early. Like, these guys know each other. Like, I think some of these guys have even played in the same team multiple times. So they definitely know what type of Dota this was going to be coming into it. It's early fighting. You pick up early items, so you're capable of fighting. We're 12 minutes in, and we've got ourselves 29 kills, Cap. This is Russia.
Yep, it's...
And Ukraine.
Yeah, this is definitely full Russian Dota. That's for sure. I think that really a lot of it comes down to the Moscow 5 draft. That they, first of all, they drafted really well against the early Doom pickup, right? They don't have any heroes that are that hurt by Doom being placed. Like Phantom Assassin, yeah, she's going to be hurt a bit. She won't be able to use her mobility to her advantage. No more blink striking, no more daggers. But for the most part, she can still do damage if she's already hitting on somebody and she gets doomed. So she's going to be okay. The rest of them are completely fine. Like, if you throw it on a support, then whoop-de-doo, you threw a doom on a support. So that's not that big of a deal. So the doom is pretty well countered. Then you have the Centaur, who I think is one of the biggest counters to Doom out there, because his ultimate is a great way to be able to react to a Doom gank, right? So you have an ally who gets doomed on the top lane and is being chased down. Pop the Centaur ultimate. Get the hell out of there. You're fine from there, usually. Yeah. I mean,
well, apart from that one time when Ogre stunned him on the top lane, it's like, oh, then escape plan doesn't work.
Yeah, in that case, that's just a case of overwhelming force, right? They just use so many resources to get one kill that, go ahead and give it to them. Sure, they got a Phantom Assassin kill. They committed a lot for it. But then you look at the Slark and the way they're dealing with the Slark and the heroes that they have versus the Slark. Phantom Assassin, very, very good versus the Slark because it's high amount of physical burst damage, so you're able to get in there, potentially pop the Slark before he gets off his ultimate, but also has that miss percentage chance, with which a lot of the damage coming out from Slark is dependent on being able to get a lot of right clicks in, so she's very good. Again, the Centaur with his ultimate, with his AoE stomp, quite good versus the Slark as well, combined with all that burst damage. The miss percentage chance of the Troll, again, you know, making it hard, much harder for the Slark. But then the Tusk, incredibly good versus the Tuskar, or versus the Slark because of his Snowball. Mm-hmm. Because you're a combo, you're a burst oriented hero where you throw down your Pounce, you throw down your Dark Pact.
Yeah, couple it's right very clicks, obvious when kill. It's coming as well.
Right. Yeah. So it's not only just like you have time to be able to react, but you can also just completely screw the Slark. Say he pops his ultimate. Just to be able to try and finish up that kill. You just sit there in your Snowball and you just go like, I can wait this out. I got no problem sitting here and waiting. This is not a big deal for
it's
me.
It's like, so. I know, it's almost like the follow-up too, because you know exactly where he is, so he's going to get out of your line of sight in order to survive. So it always turns Shadow Dance into a defensive notion as opposed to an aggressive one.
Yeah.
Because if he doesn't run away out of your line of sight, you're always going to be able to Snowball to him, so you can follow him wherever he goes.
Yeah, and just the way they're running this, aggro try, right?
Yeah.
It's the reason we don't see Slarks as much anymore is because Slark is... somebody asked me this the other day. It was like, what happened to Slark? Like, why aren't we seeing him anymore? Well, look at teams like EG and Cloud9 and the success that they're having. They are exceptionally good. I would say they're some of the best teams out there at running five-man lineups. They're really good at team fights. Eternal Envy especially. I'm not sure if it's just his leadership or he comes up with these ideas, but I've always been impressed with the way that Cloud9 is able to execute team fights. They always find those right openings, you know, catch teams off by surprise, whether it's through a certain smoke gank or a certain positioning. So they're very, very good at executing five-man lineups, and that's why they oftentimes draft themselves five-man lineups. You can't run Slark against that. Slark is a good, aggressive, mid-game-oriented hero, but he's more pick-off than he is team fight. If you're far ahead, yeah, sure, Slark's really good at a team fight. But at this point in the game, when you don't even have your Blink Dagger, you don't have a single mobility item, you don't have any stat items just yet, you're really, really bad in team fights. And that's why Slark isn't seen so much anymore, because he's more about being able to snowball off of picks rather than snowball off of team fights. AoE crushes him. Just saving abilities crush him. All around, he's just really not meant for these kind of engagements that Moscow 5 are enforcing.
Sounds like there's just too much pressure, man. Too much pressure. For now, it looks like we have our players back inside the game, so we could be very, very happy with this one.
Hopefully.
Just before we do actually hit the resume button, or they might do it in a moment anyway, get on the Twitters, get on the Facebooks, let people know that we are streaming out tonight. It's a full best of three coming your way, so do not fear if this game does end quickly. We'll be back in again for game number two in just a jiffy.
Never fear, Toby and Cap are here.
Yeah, yeah. We're like Batman and Robin. We just can't decide which one's which.
I'm Batman.
Yes, sorry, not Batman.
I'm definitely Batman.
Dude.
Pretty sure Robin's a redhead anyway.
I think we can agree that Zoe would be Catwoman and Malk would be Alfred.
Yeah, I do agree.
Yeah, we can agree with that. Yeah. So,
well,
we can
agree. Alfred's pretty snarky too, so I think Malk would fit actually.
Yeah, but Malk would be perfect as the old butler. That means he's going to serve other people though. Yeah. Anyway, back to it. Get on the Twitter, get on the Facebook, so you can retweet what Cap and I also throw out there. Toby1 Dota and Dota Capitalist on both Facebook and Twitter. Cap's horrendous with his Facebook. We'll make him use it soon.
Oh, look at that. I love it. That's what I was talking about earlier. They have a great Roshan taking team, and I was expecting them to try and take the tier 1 tower at bottom first.
The only issue is this. The only issue is this. He wave of Terran directly up. It's revealed. Ogmashai just pinged it. It's like, yo, boys, they're inside the Roche pit. This stuff happened during the Summer Grand Final. Now, the poor man's shield is sitting on the deck, and now Puck, as well as Ogre, mistakes were made. They tried to come down and contest the Roshan, but they were way too late, and they're going to snowball up even further because the Observable's up on top of the cliff. They might not get all the way, but it will... He can't blink up. He can't blink up because if he does, he'll take the sun and be underneath the tier 2 tower. So they'll just take the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane. There is fortification available, which should be used now. And they can just go back door because it's got no regeneration anyway. But yeah, that wave of terror is sometimes an absolute blessing and sometimes a pain in the absolute ass.
Oh, PGG was looking for a swap there on the Puck.
If it was level 2, he could get it, but it's not. But that's like the same thing happened. It reveals the fact that you're doing Roshan, but you want it obviously because like it's 6 armor being taken off Roshan. Of course you want to have that.
Yeah.
But you really gotta be careful with the line of it, because I think Vengeful Spirit with this whole Roshan thing, we might see the resurgence of Medallion a little bit more again, because if you put a ward up on top of this cliff, wherever you wave, it will be visible unless you get up behind Roshan and wave south.
Right.
That's the only other way you can do it without being detected.
So now with the Aegis in hand, they're going to be able to take the opportunity to grab some early towers. You can see Phantom Assassin continuing to go for the aggressive build as he decides not to go for Battle Fury.
Oh, Blink, Hofstomp, that Observer Ward, the Wave of Terror. That is the second kill that Wave of Terror has achieved tonight from PGG. But this Observer Ward, which is just sitting down here, right next to the Radiant one, right next to the Dire one as well, that scouted, like, the Dire one scouted out the Ancients moving, which is what flagged them for Roshan, and this one just scouted the Puck, sitting in this tree line, just in this little nook and cranny right there, looking for a jump in from the side.
I'm still waiting for the Moscow 5 team to go over there and beat up those dragons. You know what they're saying, Toby.
What are they saying?
Snitches get stitches. The Ancients telling all about the murder of Roshan. Snitches get stitches, man. It's good to be back.
I've almost forgotten how enjoyable it was to cast with you, Cap.
Almost. 2-1 tower's gonna fall. Almost. They're gonna be
Cap will be solo casting tomorrow.
7,500 net worth. 7,500 experience league. Moscow 5 are just executing this so well. And they have better late game as well. That's the beautiful thing. When they're already ahead, this team, I think, definitely has better late game because the Phantom Assassin is obviously great, but...
You've already got an Abyssal Blade on the PA. Like, this is a PA.
Does she actually have an Abyssal Blade?
Yeah, she... Oh, no, not the Abyssal Blade. Sorry, Basha.
Okay. She's like, what? 15-minute Abyssal? That's record-setting,
that will be impressive. Considering it's a 9-1 PA with an 8.6K net worth.
Yeah.
If they took a couple more towers than they did, then yeah, sure, maybe. But yeah, no, not sorry. That's what happens when I go on a break. Yeah. But you've already got a Basher, and you're going direct attack build. Like, this isn't a let's farm up for late game. Like, if I'm farming, I'm farming corpses. Like, this is what I do. I pickpocket everybody after they're dead. Like, this is what PA is really built for in this matchup. And it's perfect, because there's no reason to say, well, once we're ahead, let's just get further ahead by farming up. Like, this isn't the way the Moscow Fires lineup is designed to win. It's designed to pummel Deucer into the deck, take the towers after you take the kills, and keep pushing them up until you're at a point where you've actually managed to kill them all off outside their base and you can walk in and take high ground. Like, that's going to be the goal right now. Mm-hmm. Have you really missed Twitch chat that much, have you?
Reacting to... I love the forehead emote. That one going off when Hearthstone, Ben Broden, was laughing. Please tell me you've heard him, right?
No.
Hearthstone?
I've been watching a lot of I gotta say Hearthstone. I get in trouble from so every fucking time.
He has the most infectious, most beautiful laughter everywhere.
Is it like a YouTube highlight video of this stuff?
Oh, there's definitely is. You get him and Artosis together laughing. Oh my god, it's beautiful.
I will find a highlight video tonight.
It's
and
funny.
Watch
in,
it.
In Baku, Tasteless made the joke that Artosis has 20 unlockable laughs. When you cast with Artosis, you know, your goal is to be able to crack him up and try and get some of those unlockable laughs. I thought that was the funniest concept.
That would be the best caster game ever. That would be honestly the best caster game ever.
And at one point in time, like, something really dumb happened at the night, and Artosis just, like, kind of lost it for a second, and I was like, was that one of them? Was that one of them? Jay's like, yeah, that was number 19 right there. Artosis, man, that guy knows how to laugh. I don't know how.
He has a lot of fun. He has a lot of fun during his broadcast. Still, I class him as the greatest caster in all of esports. There is no one that really comes near him at the moment.
He's definitely very impressive, that's for sure.
I am merely a worm next to Artosis. We are worms! We are not worthy!
You know, it's funny, I was when we had that group together, I was talking to them about how, like, Dota is its own, like, it seems like the MOBA games in general, or whatever the fuck you want to call them.
I don't get offended by that anymore.
But the
people get offended by that, Cap. Remember the people.
Whatever you want to call it. Dota and League of Legends, right? Well, even like League of Legends, like, you had Joe Miller going in. You actually had a lot of outside influences going in. But Dota has always remained its own isolated scene, I would say, in many ways. Like, the community itself, like, very few people whether it's pro players, community members, casters, whatever, they don't really come over from other games. And I was telling them, it's just basically because Dota, for the longest time, was this underground community. We were an underground game for a very long time, and then we blew up, but we still kept that very hardcore center, and not many people really are able to breach that very well.
Well, you look at it now, and you think about, like, who's at the top that has come over. Like, technically, if you want to go back far enough, yes, I moved from Battlefield and Call of Duty, but I don't think we can really count that, because I was also one of the initial casters for Dota. But we had AC. He tried to make it in StarCraft 2, and now cast for Dota.
He's cheating because he's got that voice. That's just cheating.
True. That's true. LD, he came later, but he was kind of always around.
Yeah, I think anybody who was in before Dota 2, like in any way, even if you were really small, I think doesn't count. I think if you try and come in like after like at TI2 or after or something like that, then I think that's what you really count as new. And the only person I could think of is maybe Ziori. He was in Han.
Yeah.
He came over. I don't think there's really, like, even if you look at the analysis casters, like, nobody knew. Oh, that really comes forward at all.
At the end of the day, you need to get the respect of the community. The only way to do that is to be part of the community from the get-go. Like, obviously, the community is obviously a lot newer, but you really need to prove yourself more than just, like, hey, like, I know what I'm talking about. It has to be, like, yo, I got respect because I've got, like, grooves on my fucking car that said I was involved in Dota for the last 6 years. Count the notches, bitch. Anthem attempting a bit of a go there in Limbo. The tier 1 and tier 2 tower was mopped up by Moscow 5, so we went back in the game. After we just go on our bit of a tangent.
They're a good 10,000 golden experience ahead now.
Yeah.
After taking those two towers, so. Yeah, I don't really know where Dusit goes from here. I mean, they have to try and go this late game. I don't think there's really any other options.
They can't go late game, though. Like, what are you going to do? Sit back with the Doombringer that never built a hand of Midas? You're not going to find the farm. I think the only way they can really get ahead of this is by finding pickoffs in favorable situations and not having things like that happen. Like, you just pounce, miss the hero, and then an instant hit. Oh, that Slark dies, like, very, very quickly. And the PA just ran through him. Oh, that is brutal.
Yeah, going into a fight that just so happens to have a Phantom Assassin already picking up double damage in his bottle probably was not great. That was
favorable situation was what I said. Favorable situation.
Yeah, you really could not paint a more unfavorable situation there. Slark misses his pounce. There's a double damage on the Phantom Assassin. They kind of miss their surprise factor.
That was like signing up to be the victim in Saw. You know it's going to end bad.
So there's only like two ways for Dusa to come back into this game, which was, as you said, maybe finding pickoffs. I think it's just like going full ham right now, like trying to force those kind of fights that they just forced and hope that they go well and somehow bring back that gold lead, or they just go super late game. And I don't think they have the advantage in the late game. I don't think that at all, but I think that that's just your only options. And wow.
This is the right. It's the right thing to do. It really is the right thing to do. Even though they haven't breached high ground right now, there really is no hope here. Like, this is the fucking ship of the damned. There's no way to really come back in this game. Like, if you had some proper setups and control that you could rely on, then you can go for it. But saying, an Ogre Magi, well, if he can get himself a 20-second stun, then maybe we can bring down that PA. But there's no way to do it. She's too fat. They had too much abilities. The draft was just so much better from Moscow 5. No momentum was able to be gained. Tap it out, man. Throw the white flag in before someone dies again.
Yep, well done by Moscow 5. Love to see their innovation in drafting, running aggro tribe with the Troll Warlord. Hopefully we'll see something interesting like that for game number 2.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it, so stay tuned, everybody. We'll be back after this, a short break for game number 2 of our best of 3. Moscow 5 going up against Team Dusa for a chance to go up against HR in the semi-finals of the winner's bracket. So stay tuned, we'll be back.